My dream,
she showed.
My dream was to become the first female prime minister of my country. It was not always my dream. I wanted a normal life, with simple dreams like eating good food, wearing good clothes. But things took a different turn, so did my simple dreams. I am a widow, but I'm still me. Of course, I mourn and I shed tears. But to carry it alone, I deserve dignity and respect, not the fears and the humiliation. This poem is me and every widow. A very good morning to everyone here. I came all the way from a very small and beautiful Himalayan country, Nepal, just to share about the social movements that I'm engaged for the widows in Nepal. I wasn't always a widow, of course. I was first born as a daughter, then when I get married, then I was reborn as a wife, and then the mother. But when my husband died, then I was born again as a widow. And this third birth was really, really challenging for me. And it has changed my whole life forever. My first life began well. I was born into a well-off family in Kathmandu city, and I bloomed like a very stunning lily in the garden of my parents, and I was charming and precious, and then I became aware of the societal expectations. I became aware that the reputation of a daughter represents the reputation of whole families, that her chastity means everything for her and her entire clan. My chastity. I couldn't believe. I rebelled again and again this, against the society, against the very patriarchy that made my mother bow down her head at her husband's feet. I wanted to study, to learn more about the world and complete my higher education. But my father who was ill, wanted to see his daughter get married. And so I married to an army doctor from a very well-off family when I was just 17. It was the next incarnation of my life, one where I had to leave my parents' house and move to my in-law's house. I changed from a daughter to the daughter-in-law, and I had to build and maintain my relations with the new people and the new household as a 17-year-old teenager. The harshest form of the marriage in South Asia is an early marriage. It limits a girl's education, increases her vulnerability to violence, and increases the chances of the teen pregnancy, and restricts her the decision-making authority within the family, and undervalues her status in the household and the family. When I become a daughter-in-law, formal study was no longer options, and I hated this. But I accepted my fate, and then destiny cheated me. One day, I got the news that my husband died while serving as a UN peacekeeper in Iraq in Gulf War. I had three young children. I was just 29. When I heard the news, I fainted. And I didn't wake up until hours. When I did, I could tell that everything had changed. I was not allowed to touch anything. I was forced to sit in one corner, and I had to throw all the colorful dresses and the red colored dresses and the jewelry that I had been wearing since my childhood, because I had become a widow. It was the darkest day of my life. My in-laws switched from loving ones to the hateful ones. They called me odious. They said that I smashed their son. They blamed me for everything. And as it was a sign from above, there was a common terminology used to all the widows in our country, is a husband eater. And our marriage vase that was decorated with lily cracked suddenly after 12 years. My husband's dead body was brought back from Iraq, and my sons, who was also very small, began fulfilling the traditional death rituals for their father. At that tender age of 29, I had no idea about my future age, what life would surprise me with. Before this incident, I had never realized that women should stand on their own feet. When I had to admit my children in the school for their education, I had no money, no other options than asking for the property of my husband. As I was quite young, I had no such idea how could I have access to the property of my husband to admit to the children in good schools, because of the legal policies which says a widow have to be 35 years of age to inherit in the husband's property. And this was really, really shocking news for me. When we talk about the death rituals in my country, we need to talk about sati. It was a system where widows would be tied up on the death pyre of our husbands and burned to death. Many of you have read in the paper as well. Because if the husband is dead, she should die too. That system is over now. But have things really changed? No. Widows are still living physically, but socially they are dead. A newly widowed woman must follow societal rituals. These rules and rituals deliberately diminish her perceived attractiveness, inhibit her sexual power, and increase her vulnerability. A widow becomes the prey of physical and sexual assaults and harassments, and is scolded with the rough words, and she is accused of various crimes and sexual misdeeds, and she is outcast from the property and restrictions on her mobility and on food. Hindu mythologies stress that a widow must follow all these kind of restrictions as well as to maintain her chastity throughout her life. I was forced to a new incarnation of my life, one of widowhood. For the first time in my life, I felt lonely and disliked. Until I lost my husband, I never realized that how society so often defines women by the men in their lives. Our identity as women is fluid and not always depending on men. When she is born, she takes the father's surname in my country. When she gets married, she has to take the surname of her husband. When she has her children, then she is addressed as somebody's mother. It made me wonder where I existed on my own. I had never expected that along with the death of my husband, I have to sacrifice all my desires, interests, and hobbies. I hadn't even completed the first chapter of my life and was doomed by my husband's death. My little son's queries his father were the most painful thing for me, though the other two were little consoled, saying that he has gone to meet God. I could do nothing than avoiding his queries, telling a lie and crying silently. His questions would pull me back towards the pleasure of nurturing my three little birds into the mature flowers. I cried for my dead husbands, but I cried for the future of my little children, so as other widows. In Nepal, as per the census 2011, 82% of the widows in Nepal is totally illiterate. Can you imagine? And 67% of the widows are in between 20 to 35 years of age, having 3 to 4 children in an average. How does a widowed woman without her husband's property educate and nurture her children? I started thinking, why these restrictions to a young widow? This discriminatory legal policy made me feel time and again that I should fight against these unfair systems. And this was the first victory of my life when I won the cases through the Supreme Court that the widows no longer need to be 35 years of age to inherit in her deceased husband's property. In the Nepalese context, The chastity of the widow is directly linked up with the treatment of the family. If any of the three relatives of the dead husbands blame the widowed wife having her extramarital affairs with someone else, she is totally legally outcast getting the property of her deceased husband. And we have many, many cases in our office. This freedom allowed the in-laws to defame the widowed woman, question her chastity, and abandon her from the husband's property. Many of our sisters were facing the same problem. And after continuous lobbying and the advocacy with the government, we have been succeeded to change these laws as well, and no one can restrict a widow on her property rights just because of her chastity. As a widow, I couldn't participate in the ceremonies. You must be very surprised to know this. And I couldn't participate, especially in these religious ceremonies. And I couldn't wear the red and the bright colorful dresses after becoming the widow. No widows can wear that. And the restrictions existed everywhere. Widows were not even allowed to meet their parents until a year of their husband's death. They have a 1 year of mourning period. And most of the widows are believed to be inauspicious and are not invited to participate in any kind of a function or religious occasions. They are treated to be someone odious and brings misfortunes in life. I will share you one incident. I remember when one of my brother-in-law was getting married and I was invited to. When I saw all the senior women of my relatives carrying a trays of the gifts for a bride, and I wanted to help them, and all of a sudden one of my relatives came and approached me that there are many others who could do this, you don't need to do this. Then I understood the underlying meanings. She and many other women, they didn't want me to touch the auspicious tray because I am in auspicious as per their rules. And this event dismayed me so much that from that day onwards, I started thinking about who has made these discriminatory practices in the name of culture and religion. And the incident forced me to ponder into a fact. Why not a man is restricted to do various things after he loses his wife? There's nothing do's and don'ts for the men who lost their wife. A man marries another woman just after fulfilling 13 days of death rituals. But a wife, when she gets widowed, her whole life gets doomed. In addition, I started thinking myself, if an educated woman from the city have to go through all these superstitions, then what would be the other women who are uneducated and belong to a marginalized family? I like red colors. I like bright colors. And in the red color and the bright color is considered as a species color in our country. But the widows in our country are not allowed to wear red and bright colors. And we cannot eat even non-vegetarian food and has to maintain the chastity and follow many more restrictions. I was astonished to discover the fact that these all restrictions have been linked up with the sexuality of widows. As you know, when we wear the red and bright colors, we look pretty, we look beautiful. When we eat non-vegetarian food, and you know, non-vegetarian food increases the sexuality of any women and men. And in fear of the getting defamed by the society and losing her rights to her husband's property, the widows gets silenced. As a result of these sociocultural stigmas that widows take into the depressions and they are psychologically traumatized. All these restrictions further stigmatize the widows to have a life full of seclusion. Even they can't enjoy their rights to body. A question always clicked me, why there are so many do's and don'ts for the widows. One fateful day, when I met a young girl, Lakshmi, from a village, who had been living the most painful life after her husband's death, I could meet her after a long struggle, as she was not allowed to meet anyone from outside. When I saw her and talked to her, I realized how hard life is for a young widow in my country. Lakshmi was just 22 and had to keep sexual relations to her brother-in-law. If she denied doing so, he would beat her 2-year-old son and threaten that he won't let child eat. Even if the whole family knows about the fact, they couldn't revolt back because he was the only breadwinner of that family. My encounter with Lakshmi made me realize that the pain I have been going through is very, very less in comparison to Lakshmi. Then I realized the level of the stress Lakshmi could feel after sharing her woes with me. And poor me, I had nothing to offer her than the words of the courage and the consolation. Then later I could help her learn swing and come out of her tragedy and to relive her life. Now Lakshmi is a big businesswoman in the village right now. And this incident fueled me from my inner heart to collect the widows from my circle and organize daily talks where they would be able to share their challenges and sufferings. In the initial phase, it was incredibly challenging to bring out the widows from the four walls of their homes, and it was directly connected to the maintenance of the chastity. Slowly and gradually, many of my friends and relatives started summing up in the Sunday forum, which I felt was quite similar to confessions room in the churches. The women shared their woes in the mass, closing all the windows and doors of the room in the fear that someone outsider would listen to them and they have to end up in the forum. And the Sunday forum became a platform for helping widows transform their sorrows into strengths. They learned to be independent and achieve what they wanted to without any discrimination. And the Sunday forum paved its way towards the legitimate establishment of organizations called Women for Human Rights, single women groups, with the motto that no discrimination on the basis of the marital status. And the Sunday forum has now transformed into a big national widows forum in the country and has been able to mobilize more than 100,000 widows as the change agents in the community. And this is the largest NGO in my country right now. And WHR, Women for Human Rights, is one of the first kind of organization in Nepal with the aim of developing widows as a change agents by providing capacity building trainings, socio-economic and legal empowerment, and thus mobilizing them towards the mainstream of the development. And also, one of the focus of my organization has been to pressurize the government to address the issues of the widows and to mainstream the widows' issues into the development agenda. I'm proud that now WHR's door is the first door where widows knock after their husband's death. And the first achievement of WHR became the passing of the national declaration using the word of single women instead of the widows in Nepali, because the word widow in Nepali society is viewed with humiliation and injury. Also, it has been able to change and reform various discriminatory laws and have further stigmatized widows women. The major step carried out was lobbying the government to collect the data of widows in the national level, in the census. The fact-finding helped WHR's movement to be more specific and straightforward. As a result, Nepal is the second country in South Asia after India having a data on widowhood at the national level. And WHR have also created the benchmarks in the Nepalese legal systems by reforming various discriminatory legal policies like rights to inherit without waiting the age of 35 years of age. I personally filed the case in my name to the Supreme Court and it has become the precedent now. And rights to retain the late husband's property after remarries Otherwise, no widows will get the property rights if she gets remarried. And rights to widows allowances irrespective of age. Otherwise, widows have to be 60 years of age to have a government's allowances. And rights to obtain the passport without male consent. And rights to sell or hand over her share of property without the consent of her son. Moreover, WHR transformed its members into change agents as change makers who become the development defenders in their local area. The groups, the single women groups, are viewed as women's peace initiatives at the grassroots level, as much initiation has come from within these groups in hopes of managing and resolving the conflict in the community. As WHR is one of the pioneering organizations in the issues of the widows, it has also contributed in forming a network of the conflict-affected widows called Nispaksha that works together a lot for a just and equitable peaceful society. WHR has now covers more than 2,500 villages in 73 districts out of 75 in my country, and has more than 100,000 members. Most of them are young widows, and it has also set up 19 shelter homes. We call it chaharis, a shed of a trees, where widows can come and stay and have social and psychological counseling to regain the self-confidence. And WHR is also able to mainstream the issues of the widowhood as a fundamental issue in the present constitutions of Nepal. And the Ministry of the Women has set up an emergency fund solely for the widows of Nepal and providing small kind of a support to live their life with dignity. And the Nepalese government also provides the small stipend like allowances to all the widows regardless of age. And WHR, as being a secretariat of South Asian Network for the Widows Movement, has been able to incorporate the issues of the widow in the Colombo Declarations in 2008. Through constant lobbying and the awareness raising initiatives, we have been successfully changed not for discriminatory legal policies against the widows in our country. Like the deceased, as I already mentioned, the deceased husband's property no longer needs to be returned after remarriage, because we just wanted to encourage the young widow to get remarried. And selling or changing property ownership doesn't require the consent of our adult sons and the unmarried daughters. And the widows no longer need to be 35 years to obtain the property. And the widows do not have to remain under chastity of a deceased husband to inherit property. And there was one policy from the government just 3 years back that who marries the widows gets 50,000 Nepalese rupees, and we are totally against that proposals of government, and we amended, been successful to amend that policy through the Supreme Court. And the widows no longer need to take a permission of our male family members to obtain passport. And the government just recently announced the practice of child marriage as an ill practice that should not be continued. Because we have in some parts of our country, most of the girls get married before first menstruation. And they go to their house after first menstruation. But in the meantime, if the boy died or the boy didn't come to take her bride, and she's considered as a half widow. We have a terminology called vaikalya. She's child widow. She doesn't inherit property from any of, nor from the parents, nor from the husbands. Just because of the success at the policy level advocacy, we have, WHR have received a special consultative status in Koshak in 2011, and we've been continuously highlighting the issues of the widows into the CEDA and the CSW, Commission on the Status of the Women. Our broader goal is to empower widows, improve and sustain the living condition of widows, and advocate for the widows' rights globally to reduce inequalities, poverty, and hardship for widows. The major crux lies in the fact that the developed countries are unaware of the such a severe human rights violations that occurs in the name of the widowhood, especially in the South Asian region. And we have a lot of facts of that, those kind of human rights violations from the South African country as well. And the Australian government and the affiliations can support this movement by assisting them by developing the widows as a human rights defenders. Not only that, we look forward to work together with the international agencies to mainstream the issues of the widows into the international development agenda and to incorporate the issues of the widows in international human rights instruments. Till now, no human rights instruments like CEDAW, CSW, Beijing have not included widows issues as a specific concern on the human rights area. We also have to work together with developed countries to acknowledge that widows as social capital for peace building and development. We do expect support to the immediate services to the highly vulnerable widows and their children, particularly those widows by the conflict and the natural disasters. And we recently just have a big natural disaster of earthquake, and I'm seeing our ex-president from NRA, Mr. Seth Scully, has been engaged to make the houses for the disaster victim. I really urge him to give more priority to the widows in that village as well. And additionally, there lies a huge gaps between the international NGO and the local level NGOs, CSOs like us, as they lack direct links with one another. And WHO also requires the necessary resources that are needed to sustain our movement. And there is also a need to equip human resources to be mobilized in the field. If WHO can build the leadership ability of the widows, the dependents, and other youths, then many foot soldiers could be equipped for the future who can continue this movement. And this readiness would prepare future potential widows for defending, capacitating, and be raising voices on their own. And the first and the foremost is of breaking the iron gate that permits the widow freely enter the restrictions from the societal privileges. There are also dire need of supporting widows in facilitating their participation in decision-making level, as a skill training, income generation programs that can help them be less vulnerable to violence and exploitation. Many widows migrate to urban centers and take on foreign employment in the hope of finding employment to feed themselves and to their children, where, again, the poverty and the powerlessness leave them vulnerable to the worst forms of exploitation and modern slavery, including trafficking. Despite of many achievements and development work have happened on widowhood, globally, there is much more to be achieved. There is still discrimination, violence, and harassment inflicted upon widows in South Asia, and especially in Nepal, but I'm ready. I'm ready to face more challenges, ready to give widows and women in South Asia and globally the respect that we deserve, and ready to take on my dream of making many, many widows at the decision-making level. Thank you all for being so patient, and thank you all for listening, and thank you for having me here today.